I decided I wanted to buy a PS4 the day I saw my first trailer for Alien Isolation. Eye-popping graphics and scene-stealing art design aside, the notion of being stalked by just one alien, instead of a whole horde of them, sounded like an exciting and much-needed retooling of a long-beleaguered IP that had finally hit rock bottom, and then started digging. Needless to say, my hopes were high. Imagine my disappointment then when Alien Isolation debuted to rather tepid reviews in October of 2014. But then a few weeks later, the civilian reviewers got their hands on it and they seemed to enjoy it quite a bit. Not really knowing what to expect, but emboldened by those amazing trailers, I went ahead and purchased my copy of the game in December of 2015. And wouldn't you know if it wasn't one of my all-time favorite stealth survival horror actioners ever made, and one of my three favorite video games based on a movie franchise. Now, I got a lot of respect for the good folks at GameSpot, IGN, and GameTrailers.com. But when I went back and reread their critiques of the game after having played it, I was surprised to find that they all seemed to be ganging up on specific aspects of the game that I thought were some of its greatest strengths. I'm here to offer a counterargument to their criticisms. Why this game doesn't and perhaps shouldn't play like every other AAA first-person shooter out there. Why it deserves a spot on your mantle, so to speak. So let's dive right in and see what we find. Alien Isolation picks up 15 years after the events of the first Alien film. You play as Amanda Ripley, daughter of Lieutenant Ellen Ripley, who travels to a derelict space station, the Sevastopol, to pick up the newly recovered flight recorder of the long-lost Nostromo, in the hopes that you might finally learn what happened to your mom all those years earlier. It's supposed to be a routine retrieval mission, but as soon as you reach the Sevastopol, all hell breaks loose. And you quickly get trapped on board with some very skittish humans, murderous androids, and at least one alien xenomorph. The game is loosely divided up into three acts, plus a prologue. The prologue is basically just a two-hour tutorial, which is really cool and moody the first time you play it, but I'll be the first to admit that it feels inexcusably long on subsequent playthroughs. It has not one, but two false starts in which the alien appears, but it doesn't actually do anything. You've seen these two moments in all the other reviews, so it's not like I'm spoiling anything here. The alien first appears about an hour into the game via this really anticlimactic cutscene. Then it makes a second appearance during an in-game cutscene where the alien drops down from a vent, stomps out of the room, and then kills two randos while you slink right on by. But after these two teases, the game finally begins in earnest. Act 1 is dedicated to dodging the alien. You start off with little more than your wits and a revolver that might as well be a water pistol. But soon enough, you find some helpful survivors and one particularly empowering defense against the alien. The first act ends when you eject the alien into the vacuum of space. Calm down. That does not count as a spoiler. You know he'll be back.
Hey! It's okay. It's supposed to happen. See?
So then the second act begins, where you face off against a new antagonist. Synthetics. Oh, so that's what those EMP mines are for. At the end of the second act, you make your way to the central computer station, and you're all like, "Computer, shut down the quarantine. Call off the androids. The alien is gone." But the computer's all like, "Negative. Alien not gone. But go check the reactor core. There's a totally unrelated issue down there for you to deal with." So you go check the reactor core. Which brings us to act number 3.
Oh no. God, no.
Act 3 throws everything at you. Aliens, androids, facehuggers, self-destructing spaceships, trigger-happy refugees, and wailing Utani operatives armed to the teeth. Even during the chaotic finale, the developers fully understand who the star of the show is, and they do well to give you one level, right at the end, where it's just you and the alien, mano a mano, with all your accumulated defenses at your disposal, the alien's powers of detection at their strongest, and a particularly unforgiving level design which incorporates lots of long hallways and very little cover. The first thing I noticed when I started going through my gameplay footage for this review was that watching little snippets of Alien Isolation can be kind of boring. Lots of walking, and waiting, and crawling. nondescript corridors, maps and computer screens, punctuated by brief bouts of messy-looking combat. But that's what I love so much about this game. It's not built to be watched. It's built to be played. This is one of the most immersive stealth survival horror games I've ever played. On my first playthrough, when the alien first dropped down in front of me, I thought I could just hide under a gurney and stay hidden indefinitely until I emerged on my own volition. You know, kind of like every other stealth survival horror game on the market today. But no, if the alien has any line of sight on you, you're dead. There are no magic safe spaces. Storage lockers are probably the closest thing you can get to an indefinite safe space, but even if you fidget too much when you're inside, the alien will notice. And God forbid you climb into a locker within earshot of the alien.
I smell something.
It's coming from over here.
It's the chubby boy!
The alien itself is one of the more compelling opponents of any game I've ever played. When no one is actively influencing it, the alien's path is completely random. You can't just memorize his route and skate on by when you know he won't be looking. The trick of the game is to come up with an escape plan that accounts for all possible contingencies, and then grow the nads to actually pull it off. If you do your job right, if you memorize the layout of the level, you plan your route accordingly, you initiate your initial distractor while keeping your noisemakers on speed dial, and then you make your way to the end of the level while you monitor your motion tracker like your life does actually depend on it and you manage to survive, it doesn't look like much has happened. But it did. In your brain. That's what I mean when I say that this game is way more fun to play than it is to watch. Here, look, this is the music that's playing through your head whenever you're walking down a corridor in the game. So that's the game in a nutshell. A masterfully paced survival horror that's as tense as it is fun. So why did it get such a lukewarm reception from all the mainstream review sites? This is the part of my review where I think it's best to tackle some of the more prominent criticisms point by point. I heard several reviewers complain about the part of the game where the alien is gone, and you're fighting the androids.
There's an oddly extended alien free stretch midway through that pits you against aggro androids instead of organic terrors.
But for me, this section of the game was a welcome relief. The first act, the part where you're avoiding the alien, only lasts just long enough for you to get the hang of dodging the big boy, and then, before it gets boring, you switch to the androids. Since you play the aliens defensively and the synthetics offensively, I appreciated having two separate sections of the game where I could refine these two skill sets independently. You can imagine how many offensive strategies would be instantly nullified by the presence of the alien. Or here, you don't have to imagine, I can just show you. Other people complained that the androids amounted to little more than an annoying frustration. Something to slow your progress down any given corridor, not an enjoyable challenge. That was like one section of the game. When the androids first go rogue and you don't have anything to fight them with, so you just have to run the length of the level getting grabbed every 50 feet. I wrote that section off as an interactive cutscene. Once you get the cattle prod, and the EMP mines, and the Molotov cocktails, and then the bolt gun, you'll find you're suddenly at your most badass. I also found it particularly satisfying to use my environment to take out the droids, like a cross between Sarah Connor and Rube Goldberg. I also like that the alien doesn't attack the androids, and the androids don't attack the alien. Almost like a professional courtesy. It makes sense to me. The alien can probably sense that the androids aren't organic and therefore not a threat, and the androids are most definitely under orders to protect the alien. So they manage to coexist quite peacefully. Enemy, I The third common criticism I heard was that sometimes combat can feel a bit sloppy. Unpolished. Crude. And I'd have to agree. But that's what violence is. I mean, in real life. It's not suave and cool. It's jarring and messy. And not that video games should always attempt to emulate real life, especially when it comes to violence, but I for one can appreciate a game that doesn't try to make me feel like an uncompromised badass at all times, but rather a game that makes me simply happy to have survived. It makes the rare moments of a game where you do feel like a badass that much more satisfying. The fourth and final complaint I want to address is the flack that the flamethrower got from GameTrailers.com, which I only bring up because GameTrailers.com is usually so spot on.
Eventually, you acquire a flamethrower, which dramatically changes the tone. A few short blasts of fire are all it takes for the alien to screech and then scurry away into a vent. What was once a menacing monster becomes little more than a nuisance.
I'll admit, the game definitely changes genres once you get your hands on the flamethrower. It switches from a survival horror to something of a stealth actioner. But I, for one, don't think a straight survival horror could have maintained my interest for more than 4 or 5 hours anyway. And while it's true that the alien does turn tail and run whenever you blast it, flamethrower fuel is generally in very short supply. So once you get the flamethrower, it's not that the tension is gone. It's simply that the fear of getting caught by the alien is replaced by the fear of running out of flamethrower fuel. Even if you never do run out, and GameTrailers.com specifically said they never did, the fear of running out is always there. Not to mention, in the final act of the game, when the alien is at its most aggressive, it suddenly takes 2 or even 3 flamethrower blasts to make it go away. So the flamethrower is less of a weapon and more of a temple token. It doesn't let you defeat your enemy so much as live to fight another 30 seconds. Alien Isolation isn't perfect. Some sequences do get more than a little tedious, it doesn't always do a good job of telling you what your next objective is, the control scheme can be a bit wonky, the collision detection could use work, maybe about 20% of my deaths felt totally random and unfair, and the last 15 minutes feels like a tacked-on chore. But when you're attempting a game this bold and innovative, I wouldn't expect everything to be perfect anyway, and I applaud AAA titles taking risks like this. Needless to say, I was very sad to see that not only was Alien Isolation probably not getting a sequel, it wasn't getting a sequel with impunity. This sucks. In an age where games are being sold on little more than front-loaded hype, it makes me sad to see underrated gems go unnoticed or undervalued. I almost feel like the mainstream reviewers actively sabotage people's impressions of the game with hundreds of montages of players getting killed. Yes, you'll die, but the source of fun here isn't supposed to be in dying. It's in surviving, in overcoming, in not getting killed, in realizing that you've got more agency than you know. That's the unspoken message of the game. You gain power not by upgrading your armor and ammo, which is just another way of saying by making the game easier, but by getting better at the game mechanics themselves, by planning for all contingencies, by being bold but not reckless, by knowing your limits and the limits of your enemies. I am the danger inside this footlocker, asshole. In short, you gotta know when to hold them and know when to flamethrow them. For those of you familiar with my Schlock and Awe series, you'll know I'm not a fan of numbered scoring systems for movies, and my feelings towards video games are no different. So instead of awarding Alien Isolation with some quantitative score with delusions of objectivity, I'm gonna give out a personalized, cumulative, qualitative award that recognizes all of the game's specific subjective merits. I should also probably mention that this whole award system is lovingly plagiarized from Acorn Cinema, the channel that first convinced me I should start my own vlog. Come back, Ed! We miss you. So with that said, here we go. Alien Isolation gets the Gloria Gaynor Award. Because, well, you know.